roughly?
That's 2 points.
You're not being graded?
No, I know.
3, 5, 7, 10.
At 15 plus.
She gets math. So do I, 15. So she's been at it for a while. Yeah. Thanks, Angela.
Mm-hmm. We built the fancy spot.
Here we go.
So this is a one-of-a-kind piece. There's no other one like this particular one in the world. And you can see the tracks go this way. And it's really cool because it records much more accurately. Oh, shit. Oh, my God.
That was for real, wasn't it?
That was for real. How Mark was feeling yesterday with the one-of-a-kind camera upstairs.
Thanks for the self-respect. Oh, yeah. Oh, that was what that was about.
He was more nervous than we were with that camera being in his possession.
So this guy came by. If you didn't go upstairs, who waited upstairs to... So that we had Jacques Cousteau's camera upstairs and the first camera that went up on the first space
the
shuttle.
The only camera to ever go to space. And
what's that?
The only one that ever came back.
Oh, so the scrap on the moon still from the first one,
yeah.
Right? So this guy, Nikon, hired us to do some displays, which we will no doubt execute brilliantly, right? Tony and Seth and everybody else. Anyhow, he's up here and he brought the whole collection up to make sure all the stuff was set up. And it's like, don't touch. But these guys got the handle and the hold and it was like, this is cool.
Very cool.
So that they're trusting us is pretty, it's a testament.
Yeah.
So.
Very cool guy too. Photojournalist, we gotta put some of his stuff.
Could be great for our blog.
Yeah. Somebody got a blog there.
Unless you order pizza, the answer is yes. I can live without you. Bill Murray.
It's mine really quick, 30 seconds. This Friday, Words Night. Non-violent related, everybody's invited. It's a great little thing we do if you're so inclined towards the words. It's kind of like an open mic variety show. Time to share stories, poetry, songs, stand-up routines, soapboxes, skits, monologues, improvs, anything and everything verbal and word-oriented, original or not. So if you're interested, let me know. Once people get together, have libations, loosen up, and then come together, and it's a really, really great setting. Usually about 30 to 45 people, and it's kind of lively, and it's awesome. So if you're interested, tell me.
Where?
Friday night.
Where?
Ask me afterwards. I'll tell you. It's in town.
Okay.
At a home by the hospital.
Don't touch that. Also, John and I are here modeling the current current idea for a stitched, more formally thing. This is a medium, in case you want to get an idea for the fit. So what is your general idea? Did anyone comment on John about how handsome he looked this morning?
Without the shirt on.
Without the head, just this part? You guys, anyhow, take a look at these and put one on and decide what a medium or a large feels like. Let's leave them here because the sizing can be weird, but I kind of dig this. It's got pockets that we can actually use, I think. So I just want to kind of do another layer of company stuff, and I thought this might be a little bit better than just another polo. So we'll just leave it right here on the radius. Try it on, decide. Pick a size, maybe we put a sheet and say, look, between those guests, okay? You get that list together, put your name by it. Thanks for doing that list, Alice.
Coming to you shortly.
Hey, so we've got footballs we're looking for this. It had a very large overstock. So we get this next day from Home Depot. We're moving down to 12 sheets of stock for a reorder. We got a reorder point here. We're gonna have a table here for that free up when you get a new bunk in.
What about you here?
We'll do the same thing for the one below.
Okay. Thanks, Patrick. Facilitates a follow-up conversation. Steve, what do you know?
May not have been completely obvious, but the Kanban card, when it velcros onto there, sits at about 12.
12 pieces?
Huh?
Got it. So whoever's in that department, just get real clear that we want to get it timed for the Home Depot stuff, which can come in, what, next day? Pretty consistently?
Yeah, next day, 2 days sometimes.
Okay, if you get Grego direct, he's pretty much on it. But what we're trying to do is just bring a new sheet in there, a new bunk in, without having to put it around, stage it, move around. And the idea is there should be enough extra room that you can maybe pull that off.
If you order it too early, the bunk won't stay.
Right.
Correct. Thanks, Rob. Thanks for making it lean. Hey, Mike, can you talk to us about the Corral de Oro?
Well, the Corral de Oro,
what is it?
It's stuff that needs sorted. It's not.
What is it not?
It's not a free bin.
Oh.
And it says right there clearly.
Oh, okay. They just need to get back to their home. So it doesn't mean that things that are in there aren't available for mooching or something, but it might be good to just run it by the channel. So for what it's worth, you might go, hey, you're going to use that, or you're going to stick it back in that trailer and ignore it. Fine, take it. That's all.
That
just double check.
Is that a paint can or is that a pop can?
Coffee cup.
Yeah, next. Yet another coffee cup.
If it's yours, grab it.
Take it. Hey, little intentionality. What do we got here? Can you kind of show me what you see, guys?
That's my fault.
Well, okay. So what do you see? Remain anonymous for a minute.
I left my cuttings there.
Okay.
I would say it's not my dad, but he's got to clean up a little bit of it.
Nope. And the guard.
Got it. So there's two issues, right? So we want to minimize the... Rob?
I know why it's not getting cleaned up. No one wants to wait around for 10 minutes for the thing to stop spinning.
Yeah, we should get a break for that.
Because it takes forever.
Yeah, the break for that thing is called the new model. I should have
bought it. I'm sorry, that's probably why it gets left.
Okay,
I'm guilty too.
Coming to a Corral de Oro near you soon will be a nice bandsaw without a break. You have to sign a waiver. Just kidding, maybe. Be done.
You got a garage. So in the name of respect
for people, that's it. I created, as an improvement, a bin where we could throw those parts that would hold the quantity, keep it off the floor, make it sweepable. So actually, if you bring that blade down during that process, in my opinion, you can clear those things out using a piece of the scrap and get it out of the way carefully. Been doing it for decades, but yeah, it requires a certain amount of care. And I would agree, if you're that close and you're going, it's bad move. So I'll go call those guys about it. But if it's easy and you can shush it out of the way with your other scrap, then just do it. And don't sweep your hand across it, though.
That's why we have 10 fingers.
Across the meat.
Yeah, don't sweep. Don't do that.
That thing continues to spin for a while.
Okay, I'm going to buy a
Okay, put that on my list.
Buy a bandsaw. Powerful reminder. Buy a saw. Go ahead. Safety. Courtesy.
John.
The clock. That's all.
Good.
And agreed to take a break from 10 to 10:15 in the morning, and another break at 2:30 to 2:45, afternoon break. Try to make it mandatory. We all need to recharge mentally. It's a healthy thing to do. Yeah, let's do it.
I know the 2:15 or the afternoon break. Historically got ignored because FedEx was just about to show up and it was just no one could. So I think if FedEx is showing up at 4 like they're supposed to, we could probably do that. But if they are showing up at 3:30,
if they show up early, come grab you.
They're supposed to be here at 4.
Yeah. Between 4 and 5.
I do know we had a period where these guys just would lounge for like an hour. I don't know what that was about.
They parked down on the side down there.
Okay.
They've been parking down the road.
Like they're totally chill. Like I said, guys, come in, use the bathroom, whatever.
Yeah.
One free mate per month. That's it. Okay.
And what's plan of attack for today, staying wise?
Well, I mentioned that just because we've been working later each day, so we've got room for that afternoon break. So let's call it 2:30 to 2:45. And today, let's at least work till 4. If you can work later, keep pushing.
Cool.
Does the floor have a plan for moving resources around to see if we can turn some of this red into yellow?
We're working on it. We're doing it. But it's still red. Tony?
What about lunch?
Lunch is coming?
Yeah. No. Hours.
12 to 1.
Lunch efficient.
Oh, thanks.
Return by 1. Okay. Return at 1. Let's tighten it up.
That sounds good.
Even if the meeting goes too long.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's some flexibility there, but.
Lunch is. Anyway.
Grab it. Thanks.
All right. PDCA. Who knows what that means other than what it means?
Plan, do, check, act.
But what does it mean?
What does it mean? Well,
go ahead.
Don't be back behind me. Go ahead.
Oh, all right. So it's just a method of improving a process or really anything that you're gonna make a plan, you're gonna try it, you're gonna look at your results, reflect on it, and then adjust accordingly. And so it's not a one-time thing. It's not plan, do, check, act, done. I did that. Good job. It's a cyclical thing. So you plan, you do, you checked, and then you're actually gonna act by starting over, really.
It's a
loop
or a process, right?
It's
never done.
Agree, Steven? Anything to add or
no?
Cool.
So we're bringing that up. The other day we had some fun with arts and crafts, and now here's why.
Now, today.
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 My head is always in tomorrow and the future.
Today, mostly, and some tomorrow.
I'm future-oriented, but it starts today.
Yeah.
Brought to you by...
Easy. Several years ago here at TED, Peter Skillman introduced a design challenge called the Marshmallow Challenge. And the idea is pretty simple. Teams of four have to build the tallest freestanding structure out of 20 sticks of spaghetti, 1 yard of tape, 1 yard of string, and a marshmallow. The marshmallow has to be on top. And
do
though
over.
It seems really simple, it's actually pretty hard because it forces people to collaborate very quickly. And so I thought this was an interesting idea and I incorporated it into a design workshop and it was a huge success. And since then I've conducted about 70 design workshops across the world with students and designers and architects, even the CTOs of the Fortune 50. And there's something about this exercise that reveals very deep lessons about the nature of collaboration, and I'd like to share some of them with you. So. Normally, most people begin by orienting themselves to the task. They talk about it, they figure out what it's going to look like, they jockey for power, then they spend some time planning, organizing, they sketching, they lay out spaghetti. They spend the majority of their time assembling the sticks into ever-growing structures, and then finally, just as they're running out of time, someone takes out the marshmallow, and then they gingerly put it on top, and they stand back, and ta-da! They admire their work. But what really happens most of the time is that the ta-da turns into an uh-oh, because the weight of the marshmallow causes the entire structure to buckle and to collapse. So there are a number of people who have a lot more uh-oh moments than others. And among the worst are recent graduates of business school. They lie, they cheat, they get distracted, and they produce really lame structures. And of course, there's teams that have a lot more ta-da structures. And among the best are recent graduates of kindergarten. And it's pretty amazing, as Peter tells us. Not only do they produce the tallest structures, but they're the most interesting structures of them all. So the question you want to ask is, how come? Why? What is it about them? And Peter likes to say that none of the kids spend any time trying to be CEO of Spaghetti Inc., right? They don't spend time jockeying for power. But there's another reason as well. And the reason is that business students are trained to find the single right plan. Right? And then they execute on it. And then what happens is when they put the marshmallow on top, they run out of time, and what happens? It's a crisis. Sound familiar, right? Okay. What kindergartners do differently is that they start with a marshmallow and they build prototypes, successive prototypes, always keeping the marshmallow on top. So they have multiple times to fix and to build prototypes along the way. So designers recognize this type of collaboration as the essence of the iterative process. And with each version, kids get instant feedback about what works and what doesn't work. So the capacity to play and prototype is really essential, but let's look at how different teams perform. So the average for most people is around 20 inches, business school students, about half of that, lawyers, a little better, but not much better than that, kindergartens, better than most adults. Who does the very best? Architects and engineers, thankfully. 39 inches is the tallest structure I've seen. And why is it? Because they understand triangles and self-reinforcing geometrical patterns are the key to building stable structures. So CEOs, a little bit better than average, but here's where it gets interesting. If you put an executive admin on the team, they get significantly better. It's incredible. You know, you look around, you go, oh, that team's gonna win. You can just tell beforehand. And why is that? Because they have special skills of facilitation. They manage the process, they understand the process. And any team who manages and pays a close attention to work will significantly improve the team's performance. Specialized skills and facilitation skills, the combination leads to strong success. If you have 10 teams that typically perform, you'll get maybe 6 or so that have standing structures. And I tried something interesting. I thought, let's up the ante once. So I offered a $10,000 prize of software to the winning team. So what do you think happened to these design students? What was the result? Here's what happened. Not one team had a standing structure. Not one had, if anyone had built, say, a one-inch structure, they'd have been taken home the prize. So isn't it interesting that high stakes have a strong impact? We did the exercise again with the same students. What do you think happened then? So now they understand the value of prototyping. So the same team went from being the very worst to being among the very best. They produced the tallest structures in the least amount of time. So there's deep lessons for us about the nature of incentives and success. So you might ask, why would anyone actually spend time running a marshmallow challenge? And the reason is I help create digital tools and processes to help teams build cars and video games and visual effects. And what the marshmallow challenge does is it helps them identify the hidden assumptions. Because frankly, every project has its own marshmallow, doesn't it? The challenge provides a shared experience, a common language, a common stance to build the right prototype. And so this is the value of the experience of this so simple exercise. And those of you who are interested may want to go to marshmallowchallenge.com.
Thanks. Good material. Thank you.
Who learned something from building a marshmallow tower? Brad.
So one extra thing I learned was the whole time I knew that Junior had done it once before. And yet I didn't stop and say, hey, Junior, what the hell should we do here? Junior might have said, well, you know, most towers gonna fall over. Don't try to make one 39 inches tall. See if you can make one 12 inches tall, we'll probably win. I think that's what he would have said. But I didn't ask.
I watched this video for the first time 20 minutes ago, half an hour ago. But I knew that everyone fails because they don't check in the middle. So that's why I was trying to get everyone who'd done it before into one group so that wouldn't be spoiled.
Yeah, that was a really interesting thing. Junior, how did you feel about, where are you? Did you feel like you might, did you think about it and not speak up?
No, I just, I felt like Brad had a good plan and I just went along with it, so.
So, what did we learn from one of our Malcolm Gladwell books about aviation and pilots from South America? Does anyone know?
Korea.
What's the story?
Outliers.
Highly relevant?
There's a bunch of, they had most plane crashes of any airline in the world out of Korea, and they applied the kind of respect differential where they graded every single country on the differential between the guys at the bottom of the totem pole and the top and how much respect there was. In the U.S., there's very little differential. It's a very low ratio. But in somewhere like Korea, where it's an honor society, you know, a subordinate does not talk up to the leader. So you had the co-pilot sitting there being like, I think we should check the thing. But they wouldn't say anything.
Yeah.
Mm. And the pilot would be going along because the pilot's supposed to be the one in charge. And there was no team kind of communication.
Yeah, and what happens is that the basically number of stories repeated like this where the pilot, seasoned pilot, I got control, I'm the gorilla, man. And it's like he's focused on one problem, something's going wrong. And the co-pilot goes, we got to land. I don't care whether the gear is up or down or not. He's like, we almost got it. He's like, we're out of gas now. And then they fall out of the air. So they actually, the FAA, switched the seating arrangement and the hierarchy, and there's often the co-pilot is the one actually piloting, and so it's that idea that a guy should be able to say, hey Brad, I don't care if you got a degree, just shoot for a foot, we'll win, you know, you can trust me on this one. Okay, so it's that, so there's a lot of more nuances in terms of organizations that can really have a huge impact.
Yeah. They also forced them to all speak English because built into their language was that type of hierarchy.
Right.
But in the English language, it's more flat. And because they're both on level playing field, because it's their second language, that also created less of that differential.
Yeah, there have been South Americans who have come up and dealt with rude New Yorkers, and people died because they weren't like in their face.
Right.
New York control tower guys are jerks.
They got afraid of this.
They got afraid to even speak up. And here, these guys are, you know, lives at stake. I mean, ran out of gas. Real stuff. So, on a more up note, that was fun.
Book club. We're at the meeting today. Grab a slice, come up.
Okay.
Yay.
Cool.
Speaking of.
Very good.
International Pizza Day. Thank you, Bill Murray. Shout outs, John.
Shout out to Mark for mind blowing service for working on the bifolds.
Oh, thank you for that.
Appreciate it.
We got a shout out for John for knowledge sharing.
Thanks, Junior. Estefan.
Dallas for picking up some coffee yesterday. I picked up cream. Didn't know we needed coffee, too. He went out and grabbed some coffee, so.
My pleasure.
Lots of appreciation there.
Ben Adams for collaboration and hey, Junko.
Thank you. John Gregg, Family Strong. Thank you.
I got one for Mitch. He's doing great and detailing. He's learned a lot and he's getting it. Thank you.
You're here.
What thing? Caesar or Cesar?
Caesar.
Caesar. For showing up.
Yeah.
Your friend of Jeremiah's over at Aqua Hot, is that correct?
Grew up with him.
No kidding. Oh. So who here met Jeremiah? Is he cool? Keep your hands up.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Big guy.
Cool guy.
That
speaks volumes for you. Aqua Hot. You know by the company Jeremiah. You keep.
Oh, it's a different one.
Is that?
Oh, not our Jeremiah.
No. Jeremiah.
No. Oh, different Jeremiah.
Okay.
Different
Jeremiah.
Bustamante.
Bustamante.
Yeah.
Bustamante. Take away Jeremiah.
Jeremiah from Aqua.
Aqua.
Jeremiah from.
Oh.